We're now going to study the average and marginal versions of graphs 3, 5, and 7. Start with graph number 3. I'll do the marginal first. I'm sorry, the average first. The most interesting point for the average is shown by this line. Okay, this point here, which is where average reaches its minimum. So before that point, the average is generated by the slope of lines like this one. That's pretty high. And to the right of that point, it's generated by the slope of lines like this one, and that also is a steeper slope. So this point represents the minimum of the average. Now graph number 4 isn't completely lined up vertically with graph number 3, so I'm not going to draw it all the way down, but that would be this point in graph number 4. It's the minimum of the average. Of course, graph 3 is the variable cost, so the average is average variable cost, or sure, an average variable cost. Now, how about the marginal? Well, by construction, at this point, the marginal is going to be the same as the average. I constructed that orange line so that it was just tangent. So this is a place where marginal and average are the same. In other words, at this point, marginal and average were the same. To the left, average is falling, and so you know that marginal has to be below it. And to the right, average is rising, so you know that marginal has to be above average to the right. In terms of the shape of marginal, well, we've seen this kind of shape before, so I'll just discuss things fairly briefly. It starts out steep, it gets really flat over here. It's extremely flat. That's the bottom part. That's the part where the marginal is the smallest. That would be here in graph number 4, where the marginal is the smallest. And then the marginal starts recovering. And by the time you get to the right-hand tangent line that I've drawn here, the marginal's gotten up. And then it gets really steep. So towards the end, the marginal is really steep, so that's why the marginal's really steep over here. So that explains graph number 4. For graph number 6, well, we're going to have the same actual marginal as we have in graph number 4, because the shape in graph 5 is the same as the shape in graph 3. So I'm not going to say much more about that. The average is going to be different, and notice something here. In the beginning at q equals 0, you have a line drawn from 0 to fixed cost, which has a slope of infinity, so the average is going to go to infinity at q equals 0. Whereas in graph number 4, the average variable cost wasn't infinity at q equals 0. Let me repeat. In graph 6, average total cost is infinite at q equals 0. I should move that around a little bit. So at q equals 0 in graph 6, average is infinity. But at q equals 0 in graph 4, average is not infinity. In fact, in graph 3, it's not possible to draw an average line at q equals 0 because the line would have a length of 0. Whereas in graph 5, it certainly is possible, I did it already, to draw an orange line at q equals 0. It's vertical, and so it has an infinite slope. So that's the biggest that average can be. What's the smallest that average could be? Well, the smallest that average could be is roughly here, that point. Between these two points, so over here, average is going to be falling. You have lines like this and this and this, so average is falling. And to the right of that point, average is rising. So this point represents the minimum of average, which would be right here. And then in terms of marginal, well, by construction, this chord that I drew from the origin to short run total cost, I drew it in order to be tangent to SRTC, because that'll tell me where the minimum of the average is. Therefore, by construction, since it's tangent, that's also the tangent line. So marginal is going to be the same as average there, so marginal is the same as average in graph number 6 at that point. Marginal is U-shaped, just like it is in graph 4, and to the right, on the right-hand edge of the graph, marginal, you can see here, it's going to be a lot higher than average. So that explains graph number 6. Now, how about graph 8? Well, 8 can be described in two different ways. You can get it from graph 7, or you can get it by superimposing graph 4 and graph 6. And it's useful to think about both of those. First off, graph 4 and graph 6 have the same marginal. So the marginal, short-run marginal cost, is just one curve. You don't have to say short-run marginal variable cost and short-run marginal total cost. That was the point that I made over here before. And clearly from graphs 4 and 6, both of the short-run averages, both short-run average variable cost and short-run average total cost, are U-shaped. Graph number 4, we know that short-run average variable cost starts here. Now, there's a theorem which I'm not going to expect you guys to know. The theorem says that if average cost, or the average value of any function at q equals 0 is less than infinity, then the average equals the marginal at q equals 0. Now, I've written it here for costs, but let me say it out loud in a general mathematical form. If the average value of a function at q equals 0 is less than infinity, then the average value of the function is equal to the marginal value of the function at q equals 0. Now, when I teach 7005, I have students prove it. It's an elementary application of what's called L'Hopital's rule, which some people learn when they take freshman calculus. But since we're not getting into mathematics that way, I'm not going to prove it here. And since in this class, I don't really expect you to know things that you can't prove, it's perfectly okay for any of these average and marginal graphs if you just don't draw what happens at q equals 0. If you just start your graph ignoring this initial part, so you start the lines like here and here. Furthermore, if you get this thing wrong, if you don't take my advice and ignore the values of low q, but instead you go ahead and draw them all the way to the left-hand axis, and you do it wrong, I'm not going to take any points off. I'll probably mark on your paper that is wrong, but I won't take any points off because I don't expect you to understand something that you can't prove. But my graphs are drawn correctly. When I do draw things all the way to q equals 0, then I have it drawn correctly, and that's the reason why in graph number 8 and in graph number 4 the average and the marginal are equal at q equals 0. So back to graph number 8. It's clear from 4 and 6 that at the bottom of the U's, marginal is equal to average. And actually, then, that generates graph number 8. There's one other thing that you can get from 4 and 6, but it might be easier to get from graph 7. Let's try to find where what Q values the average reaches its minimum. I'm drawing the lines now. And if you draw this carefully, you'll be able to see that the minimum for average variable cost doesn't happen at the same time as the minimum for average total cost. The minimum for average variable cost happens here, and the minimum for average total cost happens here. And you can see that in graph number 8. The minimum for average variable cost happens here, and the minimum for average total cost happens here. So the one for average total cost happens to the right. Now, you know that anyway from graphs 4 and 6, because at this point, short-run marginal cost is rising, and so that would actually be the only way to draw the curves. But you can see from graph number 7 another way to do it. The other thing that I pointed out before in the previous video is that the gap between short-run average total cost and short-run average variable cost gets smaller and smaller as you go from right to left. They never touch, but as Q goes to infinity, that gap goes to zero. The best idea in terms of studying for an exam is not to try to memorize these, but rather to understand the principles involved in obtaining them. If you understand the principles, really all you have to do is know graph number 1, which is type 1, that's from the previous chapter, and you can get everything else from that. Perhaps a bit tedious, but if you understand the explanations, then you'll be able to give me back the explanations on the exam, and that's actually also what the exams demand, are explanations of how you obtain the results, not trying to memorize them.